Former President Bill Clinton is joining us today from his home in Chappaqua, New York. Mr. President, welcome to the broadcast. I want to ask you about your Clinton Global Initiative, but I have to begin with a news question because we have confirmed reports that tomorrow the president is going to propose a new tax on millionaires, everybody who makes over $1 million. This tax would ensure that they have to pay at least the same percentage of their income as middle-income taxpayers do. Do you think that's a good idea?
I do. I don't know when it's supposed to take effect. You know, my position has been that we need a long-term deficit reduction plan along the lines that the Simpson-Bowles Commission and all these other bipartisan groups have proposed. They all contain both spending reductions below what everybody thinks we'll spend now and revenue increases. And if you look at the group that has had the biggest income increases and the benefit of most of the tax cuts of the previous 8 years before the Obama administration took office, those of us in that income group, we're in the best position to make a contribution to changing the debt structure of the country. But right now, and I think the president's doing the right thing to put out a budget plan. I don't know when the timing kicks in for these things, but I think that we need to focus right now on putting the country back to work. And I'd like to see the economic plan that he talked about in his address to Congress enacted first. Then when the economy starts growing again in a year or two, then I'd like to put the hammer down on this deficit problem.
All right. Well, your Clinton Global Initiative kicks off its seventh year this year, and you are going to be focusing on creating jobs with business people, with CEOs, with smart people from all around the world. I can guarantee you the Obama White House is going to be listening. What do you think is the secret? What do they need to do to start getting people back to work here?
Well, first of all, it is a problem nationwide. I mean, worldwide. There are hundreds and hundreds of millions of people looking for jobs all over the world who don't have them. And one of the most successful things I've been able to do in Haiti, for example, is to help the arts and crafts people be stronger than they were before the earthquake. So this is a problem worldwide. But I think that what we try to do is to deal with the world as it is. So, for example, if the banks aren't loaning money to things that I think will create jobs, we look for other ways to do it. The pension funds of the labor unions and the public employees have a lot of money that isn't earning a lot in the stock market now. So under the leadership of the AFL-CIO president, they actually want to create jobs for a lot of small businesses by investing in building retrofits. And I think you'll see more announcements on that there. I think that this idea of onshoring jobs, that is creating jobs in rural America in areas of high unemployment that used to be sent somewhere overseas, is going to get a lot of attention here. There are lots of very specific things that when you add them all up can really make a difference. I don't believe America can return to the full employment days of the 90s until we clear this bank debt and over the mortgage crisis. And I hope that will be done. But in the meanwhile, I think a combination of the payroll tax changes that President Obama recommended, the setting up an investment bank and doing more in infrastructure, and then looking at areas of specific opportunities to put people to work can really create millions of jobs and get us out of the worst of this doldrum. And that's what I'd like to see America focus on.
Well, do I take it from your first answer, though, that you're saying, let's get the jobs programs going, get the economy moving up, and then talk about raising taxes? Is that basically what you were saying?
Well, I don't have any objection to talking about it now. And I think what the president wants to do is to tell the American people, commendable, whether it's good politics or not, it's an honest thing to do. We got a long-term debt problem. We have to deal with this. Here's my long-term plan for dealing with it. But right now, we've got an economic problem. And the truth is that we're never going to balance the budget again, as we did when I was president, without a combination of three things: spending restraint, new revenues, and more economic growth. If you don't have all three, we can't get a hold of the debt problem. And you have to do them in order. So the first and most important thing is to restore economic growth. I think that is the president's position. What he's saying about taxing upper income people is what he's always said. I don't think that's such a draconian thing. He basically is asking us to return to the tax rates of the 90s for the wealthiest Americans who have been the big beneficiaries of this last decade, which has been very tough on the middle class and low income people.
Mr. President, your old advisor, James Carville, said flatly that things are so bad that the president's approval ratings are down and so forth, so bad that it's time for panic at the White House. He basically suggested firing everybody over there. You think that would be the right thing to do?
I think the right thing to do is what the president did. I thought he gave a good speech to Congress with an economic plan to deal with the immediate emergency. He offered $450 billion worth of suggestions. $250 billion were tax cuts, including big payroll tax reductions that the Republicans have previously supported, and $200 billion in spending in infrastructure, in retrofitting and fixing and modernizing schools, things that will immediately put people to work. That, and then I think he's going to put out a plan to deal with the long-term debt problem and make it clear that he wants to do this after growth is returned, that you can't get blood out of a turnip. So I think that there's a little bit of lag in these polls between when a president proposes something and people feel it. Also, right now, he's just out there running against himself and people's misery. It's tough out there. You've got not only 9% unemployment, you've got who knows how many million people that aren't in the figures because they quit looking for work, and a lot of others who have part-time jobs and want full-time jobs. Everybody understands you can't do miracles. Look, what happened on September the 15th, 2008, 4 months before he became president, was a financial crash. If you go back hundreds of years, these things take an average of about 5 years to get over. If we want to speed that up, we're all going to have to work together. Now, we all know that if you look at the elections of the last 4 years or 5 years or 10 years or 20 years or 30 years, conflict makes great politics, but it doesn't make very good policy. What we need is a cooperative policy that'll put American back to work. I think that I understand what James was saying, and he wants President Obama to be reelected, but when you're out there running against yourself and people feel miserable, it's hard to see your numbers go up. When he's got a real opponent and people get to evaluate real alternatives and they get to see how the Republicans respond to his speech and his plan, including a lot of ideas they have supported in the past, then I think we'll be in a different world politically. This is about people's real lives.
Let me just ask you about one thing that our next guest on this broadcast, former Vice President Cheney, said. He said your wife, Hillary Clinton, is the most competent person in the administration, and it suggested that maybe she would be a stronger candidate than Barack Obama. I wanted to give you a chance, if you care to endorse the Vice President's statement.
Well, you know, I'm very proud of her, and so I'm always gratified whenever anyone says anything nice about her, and I very much agree that she's done a good job. But I also have a high regard for Vice President Cheney's political skills, and I think one of those great skills is sowing discord among the opposition. So I think he's right that she's done a heck of a good job, but she is a member of this administration and committed to doing it. And I think he, by saying something nice about her in the way he did it, knew that it might cause a little trouble. I don't want to help him succeed in his political strategy, but I admire the fact that he's still out there hitting the ball.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Mr. President. It's always a pleasure to have you.